Hi, I am Dr. Amber Luong. I'm an associate professor here at the University of Texas Medical School within the Department of Otolaryngology. What I wanted to talk to you about today is cerebral spinal fluid leak, or more commonly called brain fluid leak. The reason why I wanted to talk to you about this is because of the fact that this can often be mistaken for allergies. And it's something that I think that the patients often know better than the physician that there's something not quite right. So what exactly is cerebrospinal fluid leak, or we'll call it a CSF leak or brain fluid leak? Basically, it's when you notice clear fluid leaking out of your nose. The reason why patients often know that it's not quite right or it's not allergies is that it's very different from allergies, and the fact that the clear liquid often comes more from one side versus the other. So rather than in allergies where you feel drainage on both sides, brain fluid leak or cerebrospinal fluid leak is often only on one side. And what's really interesting about CSF leaks is that you can prompt it or you can get it to start leaking when you lean over. So a patient will describe leaning forward and having it drip either on the right side or the left side. If by chance it happens to go to the back of your throat, you may notice a slightly metallic, salty taste to it. And so if you have those symptoms, I think that's when you should start asking your doctor or thinking about a potential brain fluid leak. So brain fluid leaks are not very common. In fact, they're not very common in general. However, I get to see a lot of these because I'm over here at the medical center, and a lot of these types of diagnoses get referred to me. I'm a sinus surgeon that does sinus surgery as well as skull-based surgery, and that's the working on the area of the bone that separates the brain from the sinuses. So when you suspect a brain fluid leak, when should you be worried about it, or when do we start worrying about it? Well, there's pretty much three typical causes for a brain fluid leak. The most common cause, I think almost over 90% of these brain fluid leaks happen after some sort of trauma, some sort of accident, a car accident or other accidents. And it may happen immediately, or it can happen several days to even a couple weeks to months after an accident to the head. In that situation, if that is the cause or thought to be the cause, oftentimes these are treated with just a lumbar drain or a drain that's put into the back of your spine, and this takes some of the fluid off of the back to minimize the pressure on the site where it's leaking from and allowing it to heal. This may be about 3 to 5 days where the lumbar drain is placed, and that often is all that's required for that treatment. The other possible cause is after some sort of a tumor. So a tumor in the brain or in the sinuses can then grow and cause a hole in that skull base, the one that's separating the brain from the sinuses. And in that situation, the key is that we need to know that we need to treat that tumor, and then ultimately that defect can be repaired surgically. The one that's really difficult to diagnose, and the one where you'll probably be involved most in helping us make that diagnosis, is the ones that happen spontaneously. The spontaneous ones are where you don't have a history of a tumor, you are not diagnosed with a tumor, you have no history of an accident. The other cause that I forgot to mention is if you've had a prior sinus surgery or some sort of surgery done on the brain sinus area, a potential complication is a defect in that skull base causing a CSF leak. But if you don't have those situations, then there is an entity or a diagnosis where it's a spontaneous CSF leak. So a spontaneous CSF leak, it happens because we don't know what the cause is. But what we believe is going on is that for whatever reason, you have an increased intracranial pressure on the brain fluid. I should back up a little bit to give you a little bit of the anatomy. So the brain fluid is the fluid that surrounds the brain, but the fluid and the brain is covered by a lining called the dura. And then that, of course, all lives inside your skull. And separating the brain from the sinuses is this skull base. So in a spontaneous CSF leak, there is, whatever reason, increased pressure on the brain fluid. And over time, and this may be months to maybe even years, we believe, this pressure thins out that bone that separates the brain from the sinuses and eventually breaks through and creates a hole or a defect. And then once that defect is there, then the brain fluid can then leak into the sinuses, ultimately into the nose, where you'll detect it. And so those are the most common. And again, the one that I failed to talk about was if you have a history of having some sort of sinus surgery or surgery done into your nose or even brain surgery, sometimes there may have been a defect or a hole that was either undetected or not noticed at the time of surgery that then can cause a CSF leak. So what do you do, or what does a physician do when they suspect this? Well, first of all, the history and physical, or the history, is very important. So as I mentioned, leaking primarily from one side that doesn't respond to allergies, because oftentimes we as physicians think that it's allergies because it's more common. And if it doesn't respond, then we start thinking about maybe a CSF leak or something else that's going on. We'll try to collect the fluid in the clinic. The fluid is collected so that we can look for whether or not this fluid is in fact brain fluid. What we can look for is a protein called beta-2 transferrin. So we'll collect the fluid, or have you collect the fluid for us, send it off to the lab for beta-2 transferrin. If it is in fact positive, then it is most likely brain fluid leaking from your nose. Now, the second step will be to try to figure out exactly where it is leaking from. In order to do that, we get imaging studies. So imaging studies usually consist of a CT scan of the sinuses or head, as well as an MRI. The CT scan allows us to find the bone defect. So CT scans are very good at looking at the bone structure of the area. Why do we get an MRI? Well, sometimes when you have a hole in your skull base, if the hole is big enough, sometimes parts of the brain can pooch out into this defect. And we want to know that prior to considering any sort of surgical repair. So we get both the brain CT as well as the brain MRI, looking for this pooching, also called an encephalocele. So once we know that the cause, if it is spontaneous and we know where it's leaking from and we've confirmed that it is in fact brain fluids that's leaking, then the most common treatment is a surgical repair. These days, oftentimes, this surgical repair can all be done through the nose, so you don't have to have any incisions on your face or on your brain, which is a huge improvement from about 20 years ago. The surgery involves putting a camera into the nose and basically opening up the sinuses so that we can see where on the skull base where this hole is. And then with the help of a camera, we can then visualize where the actual leak is coming from. So how do we tell where the leak is coming from? Well, when you're in with your ear, nose, and throat doctor or a rhinologist, one of the referrals or other doctors that we'll have you go see is a neurosurgeon. The neurosurgeon will help us put in a lumbar drain at the time of surgery. Again, that's that drain that goes into your back. And what that allows us to do at the time of surgery is to take a little bit of your brain fluid and put some dye into it, a yellow bright dye that we put into it, and then we put it back into your spinal fluid. And this then, of course, circulates around the brain. And so now at the time of surgery, we can that dye highlights where the leak is coming from. So this allows us to not only confirm that on the CT scan where we think the leak is coming from, we can actually see the leak. And this will also help us with our repair to make sure that we can confirm that there's no further leaking. So what we do is, once we can see it with the camera and we can see where the defect is, we basically expose the defect. And after that, it's just a matter of plugging it up. So what are the things that we use to plug up this hole? Well, we can borrow some tissue from the lining of the inside of your nose to plug it up. We sometimes may need to use fat from your abdomen to just kind of plug up the hole, if it's especially when it's really small or in an area that's very difficult to get to. Or we can sometimes use synthetic material that's safe to be put next to the brain. If the hole is very big, we may have to put several layers in it, several layers between the brain and the bone, and then the bone within the sinuses. But once we have all those layers in place, and we confirm with our dye that there's no further leaking, then we put some additional packing on the inside of your nose to kind of support that repair. Oftentimes, you'll have to be admitted to the hospital somewhere between 1 to 3 days after your surgery with that lumbar drain still in your back. Over the time, that lumbar drain is to kind of take off a little bit of the brain fluid so that it minimizes the pressure just to help with the healing process and to allow this area to heal. Somewhere between 1 to 3 days, the lumbar drain will be kept in place. After that, the drain will be taken out and then you'll be allowed to go home. Probably for the next 4 to 6 weeks, we'd ask you to kind of minimize activity, take it easy, try not to exert yourself too much. Again, we're just trying to minimize the pressure in your brain to help allow that area to heal. And then at that point, you'll keep seeing your ENT surgeon back for some routine follow-up just to make sure that everything is healing properly. If taken care of properly, there should be no problems, and oftentimes this heals without any issues and you don't require any additional surgery. In some situations, people who have these spontaneous leaks, they have this a condition that causes their pressure on their brain to be higher than normal, and so you may have a couple of holes in your skull base or a couple of areas that are weak, and at the time of surgery maybe there was only one area that's actively leaking, but it is possible that over time there may be other areas that may leak. If that happens, then we may have to go in and do basically the same surgery on that other spot that's leaking. That's very rare, but if it does happen, we basically go in the same way and repair it. Now, if it happens for the third time, we may need to ask our neurosurgery colleagues to consider some sort of permanent way of decreasing the pressure off that brain. If you're concerned about this, about a brain fluid leak for either you or your family, or just want to learn a little bit more, please feel free to give us a call at the University of Texas Physicians, the Department of Otolaryngology. We work hand in hand with our neurosurgical colleagues as well as our surgical team at Memorial Hermann Texas Medical Center, where these repairs are done on a pretty regular basis.